Thank you. By witness and service. Some of you are already doing that service to you today, this morning, to get us ready to be in fellowship today, so thank you for that. Maybe it's by your financial offering, your financial discipleship, which can be completed in worship today by the QR code in the back of the pew, as well as you registering your attendance today. You can also drop it off in the offering tray, so as you come forward, they will be in the front aisle of our pew. We will get those because right now they're actually by me. But we'll get those in the front pews. Also, the offering boxes at either one of our entrances this morning. Our hope is that you find a way this morning to connect with Christ, to participate in the glory that He has in store for us. What will that be? What anticipation can we feel? Just a few announcements today. You have your two-sided piece. It's got a wonderful calendar taking us all the way through Easter. We are working on a prayer visual. Last week we passed around the clipboard. We're going to pass it around again. We have a few open spots. But you can just make sure that you look at AM and PM so when you sign up, you know whether it's 3 a.m. or 3 p.m. That makes a difference in my calendar. I don't know about you. But we'll get this passed around here in a little bit. Also, the wonderful activities that are coming up, we're taking a trip to the Abbey coming up, I believe, on March 24th. Anyone who is interested in going on a tour of the Abbey on Sunday, March 24th, we're going to be meeting in the parking lot at 2 p.m. We're scheduled for a tour. We'll load up in the bus, we'll load up in the van, we'll carpool if we have multiple people coming that cannot fit on the bus or van, but we're excited about this opportunity to come, just to go and to take a full load of people to go. Also, just to gearing up for what's coming up, we're going to have an all-church bowling on April 21st, Jump for Jesus, May 4th, that is the first Saturday in May. I'm giving you those May dates so you can put them on your calendar. They are on the back of the two-sided piece, which really is intended for you to go and stick it on your fridge. I know you've got magnets on your fridge. Just stick it on there so you can always have the calendar of what we're up to here at First United Methodist Church, Maryville. All that's going on. We say hi this morning to our online audience. Welcome to worship. Really, it's just good to be in worship together. To come and to celebrate, to sing the songs of our faith that connect to the words of God. And we're here to connect with one another. So as we prepare our hearts, I'd like to invite our acolytes to come on down as we bring in the light of Christ. Will you stand as your leader in body and spirit? To God, holds up a zeal within us by what God is able to do when we come together in prayer. In all of hearts. Gracious Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we can know you in so many ways because you have made a way available as Creator, as our Redeemer, as our Sustainer. You are the Holy One. And we worship you. Sometimes the idols of our world and our days get in our way, but Lord, help us in this moment to recognize we are here to worship you. Who you are, to whom you praise. Lord, would you tap our spirits, would you tap our hearts, that we might be ready to participate this morning, trusting that your healing has already manifested in areas of our lives where we need that healing. Trusting you as the Holy One. In Jesus Christ, Lord, you have built for us an eternal house, a temple of righteousness, a place of gracious plenty for the hungry, and abundant life for the poor in spirit. Would you fill us with zeal for the body of Christ? To the point today, Lord, when we might recognize there would be a need for tables to be overturned, tables of corruption and greed, tables of injustice. That you overturn those tables so that we may worship you in spirit and truth, that we may see Christ who is risen indeed, and we see Christ within one another. With hearts of wanting repentance, we come before you, O God, to confess what you already know. There are times, Lord, when we miss the mark, that we may see the failures before us, that you take those failures, you take those ashes of our lives, and you create beauty around us. When we are ready to participate, and a life that is built in you and around you and for you, for your grace to expand far beyond these walls, because it does, it cannot be stopped by these walls. Your grace is alive in our community. Your love and your mercy alive in our workplaces and our schools. In the place that we go shopping, there you are. Your presence already there. So many reasons to give thanks to you, Almighty God. For you have shown us the way. You have cleansed us. And that you, Lord, are opening our eyes and our ears and our hearts. That you, Lord, are opening us, our mouths for righteousness. For good words and good works to come from us. Your body. So we ask that you feed us today, Lord, as we worship. That we might have a hunger, that we might have a zeal, that you might consume us. Your amazing grace. That we might reflect on how we were once lost but now found. That you want us, that you love us, that you're holding us, that you carry us, that you care for us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that love that comes from you into us, out of us, into this world. God, we see as we follow in the footsteps of Savior Jesus, the one who has taught us to pray our Lord's prayer, as we say together as one. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, Jim. So I always think it's good to give us a little contextual summary of what's happening here and why Jesus was in the temple with his righteous anger. You see, if you open up the Gospel of John, you see that the Gospel of chapter 2 of John opens up with this beautiful wedding. It's a beautiful wedding, and if you know it, the weddings in Jesus' time were a community celebration lasting for several weeks. And the way that you just been to a wedding, can you imagine doing that celebration, the after party, and the after party, and the after party, and the party that just continues? But Jesus is here at this wedding with some of his disciples, his family, his grandmother, his dad. This is where he performs his first meal between water into wine, drinks, and his food after. And the new connection with this is one of the second story sermons I attended to the pastor of Wesley, who might have been preaching over the hours in the middle of a worship series on the miracles of Jesus. And he just barely had started, and I called out of town, and he called, "Hey, Tim, how would you like to preach this Sunday?" And I'm like, "Okay, what am I preaching?" This is the first meal. Camels, water into wine. Jesus' first miracle begins this chapter, John chapter 2, and it's a symbolic transformation of human ritual into divine sacrifice. Now, why do we say that? It's because Jesus was taking something ordinary and turning it into something extraordinary, right? The purification bath of water that were at the Jewish homes, custom, they would have those right there at the door for purification as they went into their home for washing, for cleanliness. And Jesus takes what already was there, this human ritual, and he turns it into a divine opportunity, a divine sacrifice. And John chapter 2, verse 12, it says, after this, he went down to Capernaum with his mother and his brothers and his disciples. They stayed there for a few days. And so Jesus had just gone to a crazy wedding party of a couple of weeks, did his first miracle, the course of his glory, and he's taking a little downtime, okay? I think after I exerted myself in that way, I would probably want to. And so where does he go? He goes, and he stays with his mother and his brothers. And then it was almost immediately in John's gospel, when Jesus drives crooked businessmen out of the temple, scolding them for turning a sacred place into a marketplace. John 2, verses 13 through 23 describes Jesus driving these corrupt businessmen from the temple, selling sacrifices to travelers was not really a problem. The sin was gouging people, gouging the poor, gouging the wicked. It's been enough to run into a particular turbulence. And we're going to collect suspicious losses and seduce castle. What an important time for these people, and if you didn't fall, you needed to come into the temple and purchase, or outside of the temple and purchase, a suit or a bag. Nothing wrong with that, but there is some reason to start me that is the ultimate purpose of the life of the Jesus was very Scripture certainly gives us model, and it's not just one of us. We are going to follow the Lord and study the Word of God. We might learn how we might interact and react to problems that we find in the world today. I really ask you, Apostle Paul would say, go to the sun and go down on your own. Why do you do that? Somebody needs to find a way to work this out, right? To work out our differences, to work out our struggles, and these other ideologies. Walk with Christ. Get into a relationship with Christ. It turns you away from that tables of pushing the others away instead of pulling our chairs, bring closer to the table that Christ invites us to. Will we take ourselves away from those dangerous tables of power and greed, selfishness, and pulling closer to the table that Christ has set for us? Table of that we have in our lives, is not the only way idolatry of the things that we might collect. And sometimes I believe that it's the idolatry of not letting loose of my ways that I've always wanted to be in my life. Things change. We interpret things differently because the grace of God shows up in front of us. And instead of putting a rule and a regulation in the way of someone wanting to come and to be with us fully in worship, He's asking us, how do we turn over the grievance of injustice? For righteousness to truly win. For the hope of Christ to be for everyone. For the time that matters to us.
Thank you. Thank you.
the kingdom of Christ again. Sometimes we try to shorten the liturgy for our Holy Communion, but I'm a big believer, especially during the Lent, that we hear the invitation, and that we not only hear the invitation, but that invitation heard so well calls us into confession and pardon, which sets us free to hear the good news. Beginning on page 12, Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who honestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to do your duty in the church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not loved our enemies. Forgive us, we pray. Give us faithful obedience to your Christ's name. We do not need to die for us. Thank you.
Thank you.